Ashet Children's Group presents The Greatest Inventor by Ben Brooks. Read for you by Geoffrey Breton. Prologue. Some months ago, I went to a house in the middle of nowhere to try to write a book for children. The house was big and old and came with a family of mice who lived in the walls. It was in a small village in Finland. Every few days, my friend Felix would call to check how things were going. You would like Felix. He's very tall and frequently steals chips from other people's plates. How's the book? He'd say. Oh, I'd say it's going wonderfully. Actually, it was going nowhere. I spent almost every hour of every day playing on my phone or the computer. Some days I played solitaire or poker. Other days I scrolled through pictures of friends and ex-friends and kittens and unusual pizzas. All of that time spent not writing made me unhappy. A grumbling grey rain cloud followed me everywhere. As I stood waiting for the kettle to boil, drops of water fell on my head. While cutting spring onions for a salad, thunder crashed between my ears. I couldn't seem to drag myself away from the computer. I couldn't focus on anything for longer than 3 minutes, and it felt like my brain was melting. Eventually, a month had passed, and I had no book to show for it. Felix called and asked how things were going. There's no book, I admitted, feeling miserable. I've done absolutely nothing. He sighed. You know what you should do, Felix said. You should go outside. Grumbling, I put on some fur-lined boots and a heavy coat and headed off into the snowy woods behind the big old house. I wasn't heading anywhere in particular. I just wanted to get away from the phone and computer and tried to clear my head. But winter in Finland is very dark. The sun only shows its face for an hour or two each day, never managing to melt the meter of snow that lies on top of everything. 40 minutes into my walk, everything turned completely black. I had no idea where I was. I had no torch, no phone, no food, and no plan. I shouted and my voice rang out in the darkness. Hello? I called. Is anyone there? I come from a different country, and I'm an idiot, and now I'm lost. There was no reply. Panicking, I sat down in the snow and tried to catch my breath. When would people come looking? Would anyone? No one knew I'd been stupid enough to wander off alone into an unfamiliar forest. Secretly, I blamed Felix. If he hadn't called and made me feel so bad for not having written anything, I wouldn't have gone stomping off into the wilderness. Then I felt something pulling on my trousers. I looked down. It was a giant tortoise, at least the size of a go-kart, and it seemed to want me to go with it. The tortoise didn't look particularly dangerous. It looked calm and strangely wise. Not having anything else to do, I followed it through the dark woods. We eventually came to a long, low wooden house. Its windows glowed with warm light. Firewood was stacked either side of the door, and sprigs of mistletoe hung in the windows. I knocked, and a boy answered the door. He was about 11 years old, green-eyed and black-haired. The boy was dressed in a t-shirt 10 sizes too big for him, and holding a mug of tea. He smiled when he saw me. Hello, he said. Do you want to come in? Listen, I told him. You shouldn't go inviting strangers into your house like that. I could be anyone. I could be planning to rob you. The boy frowned. Are you planning to rob me? He said. No, I told him. But you didn't know that. Good, he said. Anyway, if the tortoise trusts you, then I do too. He's a very good judge of character. Last year he bit a woodsman, and a few months later we found out the woodsman had been selling fake cheese all across Pirkanmaa. I shook my head and hoped that no actual robbers ever ended up this deep in the woods. What, I wondered, was fake cheese? I took a seat by the fire and the boy made me a mug of tea. It tasted like ice cream, mango, and those nuts that look like little brains. The tea managed to chase all the coldness out of me, and I was soon feeling calmer than I had in a long while. It's lucky he found you, the boy said, taking the seat opposite me, and pulling the giant tortoise up onto his lap. Snow's going to start coming down heavier tonight. Doubt you'll be able to get out till the morning. Oh, I said, not thrilled at the idea of spending an entire night with the boy and his tortoise. Why were you walking around in the woods alone? Were you looking for treasure? There's no treasure anywhere between here and Helsinki, trust me, I've checked. I wasn't looking for treasure, I said. Then what were you looking for? I shrugged. I was looking for some peace and quiet. I'm supposed to be writing a book, but I can't focus on anything. All I end up doing is playing computer chess or watching music videos. Ah, said the boy. I think I know what you mean. I doubted he did. Do you? I think so. Can I tell you a story? I sighed. Whenever people find out you're a writer, they always want to tell you stories. And their stories are almost always boring. Fine, I said, not wanting to offend him. You can tell me a story. And this is the story that he told me. Chapter 1. Every morning, Victor was woken by a giant tortoise nibbling on his little toe. The name of the tortoise was Saint Oswald. The name of the village in which Victor lived was Rainwater, and it sat at the bottom of a valley surrounded by three snow-capped mountains and one dark forest. Together, the boy and his tortoise would run out of the house and race to the top of the smallest mountain. Mostly Victor would win, though Saint Oswald was much faster than others of his kind. They would always arrive at the top just in time to watch the sun rise out of the horizon, wrapping its yellow arms around the hills and breathing warmth into the towns and villages that nestled amongst them. It was time Victor treasured because it was so quiet, and in that quiet, he could be alone with his thoughts. Once the village was awake, quiet was a hard thing to find. The days in Rainwater were long and physical. Villagers were busy mending and making, sharing and squawking, dragging ploughs and digging ditches, chasing birds off their crops into the sky. There was always something that needed to be done. In the warm months, crops were looked after and animals were taken out to graze. Once the snow had fallen and settled, everyone turned to indoor work, preserving foods, spinning cloth, or making tools and trinkets that could be sold to travelling traders. For Victor, it always felt like life was something that happened outside of Rainwater. Life happened beyond the mountains and the woods, in sprawling, smoky towns packed with people. Life did not happen in the cowshed, nor on the village green. Don't you want to go somewhere else? He'd ask the other kids, when they'd doze around the great oak on summer afternoons. Somewhere big and strange and full of new people. The other kids would wrinkle their noses. What for? They'd say. We wouldn't know anyone, and anyway, where would we sleep? Victor would sigh and shuffle off with St. Oswald. He learned not to share these ideas with his parents either. Whenever he did, the response was always the same. Son, they'd say, we may work hard here, but we work hard for ourselves, and not to make some rich person even richer. We own our ploughs, we own our land, we own our animals, and there's very few folk this side of the sea that could say the same. Victor didn't see what was so exciting about owning your own plough. If he had one, he'd have happily sold it for a horse so that he could set off for a grand and bustling city. Or at least he would have done if his parents had let him. Our story begins one morning in early spring, with dew still glittering on the fields. As usual, Victor was woken by St. Oswald nipping at his feet. Get off, Oz, he moaned, kicking out. Uk, uk, said St. Oswald. The tortoise launched itself off the bed. Half of the time, St. Oswald landed on his feet and happily scurried through to the kitchen for several breakfast marshmallows. The other half of the time, St. Oswald landed on his back and was forced to wait for Victor to get up and turn him over. They left the house without Victor even pausing for a glass of water and didn't stop moving until they'd reached the summit of the smallest mountain. They always rushed in the mornings. If they ever missed a sunrise, Victor would sulk for the rest of the day. The sunrise anchored him. It made him feel like part of something far bigger and more interesting than himself.
"There she is," Victor said, as the sun pushed up into a smudgy grey morning.
He sighed, closed his eyes, and took deep breaths. What would he do today, he wondered. It depended what kind of mood Mum was in. Perhaps he would be told to unstitch thistles from the wheat field. Maybe he would be made to gut and clean a catch of fish that were waiting in the icebox. Or he might be told to fetch water from the well, which wasn't the worst job in the world because you could stretch it out as long as you wanted. He might also be asked to chop wood, which actually was the worst job in the world because Mum could watch from the kitchen and tut if you sat down to catch your breath. Over the years, Victor had asked his parents for books, instruments, and models. Each time he'd been turned down.
"Will they keep us warm in the winter?"
his dad would ask, as though it was the most preposterous suggestion he'd ever heard.
"Can we eat them? Will they help us to bring in the harvest?"
Unless an object had a very clear and practical use, his parents saw no point in them all. It was a view shared by most of the adults in Rainwater. There were no crowded bookshelves in the village, no burnished trumpets, and no boxes of marbles or dominoes. There were only tools, and other tools to fix them with. Victor felt a nip at his ankle. The giant tortoise had caught the fabric of Victor's trousers in his beak and was pulling.
"What is it?" he asked impatiently.
St. Oswald kept tugging on his trousers. Annoyed, Victor opened his eyes. He glared at his pet tortoise. What was Oz trying to tell him? And then he saw it. In the distance, moving down the winding paths cut into the mountainside, was a wooden wagon. It was difficult to make out much detail, but the wagon clearly belonged to a peddler, rather than a pilgrim or a woodsman. Peddlers like this only passed through the village once or twice a year. They brought with them strange new inventions from the cities, potent medicines, the seeds of newly discovered crops, and indestructible clothes made in factories. Sometimes, for the children, they performed puppet shows or swallowed swords, or shared dark stories they'd carried with them from the other edge of the world. Everyone welcomed the peddlers. They broke up the dull rhythm of life in Rainwater.
"A peddler's coming!"
Victor bellowed, racing down the mountain and skipping through the centre of the village with St. Oswald on his heels. The people he passed threw up their hands in excitement. Back at home, Victor found his mum and dad sitting at the kitchen table with steaming mugs of dandelion tea clamped between their hands.
"You've been off up that mountain," his mum said disapprovingly. "And I bet you didn't even pause for a glass of water or a bite to eat."
"Sorry, mum," said Victor.
"Fluids," said Victor's father. "Fluids are essential for the body. You must always remember to top up your fluids."
Chapter 2. By the time the peddler had come down the mountain, the entire village of Rainwater was waiting on the village green, clutching bags of grain and old coins and anything else they could spare to trade. It was nearly dusk, and the sky had shifted from bright blue to moody orange. Pigeons gossiped on thatched roofs, behind houses dogs strained at their tethers, and the wagon rumbled over the road that led into town. It clanked as it went, rattling the iron saucepans, brooms, and hammers that hung from its sides on rusty nails. The wagon was shaped like a giant loaf of bread, a sheet of stained canvas decorated with maps of blue mold was stretched over its rickety wooden skeleton. A shaggy horse led the frail contraption. Hanging loosely from the side of the wagon was a faded banner that read,
"Swizwit's Unfathomable Creations. You will accuse your eyes of lying to you."
The villagers watched as the wagon came to a halt. A green velvet curtain twitched at its entrance.
"Ladies and gentlemen," said a voice from behind the curtain. Please bear with me as I prepare my wares for your perusal.
It wasn't until the moon had risen that the velvet curtains parted. They revealed a row of glass lanterns glowing dimly behind a small wooden podium. The peddler stood atop the podium, dressed in an old shirt with a red handkerchief tied around his neck. In the darkness that surrounded him, crickets whistled, owls hooted, and villagers gossiped amongst themselves.
"Good evening, good people," he said. "My name is Walter Swizwit, and I am the greatest inventor ever to set foot in the land of King Marshala. As your luck would have it, I am passing through this humble village on my way from the deepest east to the grand and ancient city of Kaftan Minor." The people of Rainwater were thrilled. They murmured to each other, excited about what their visitor might have in store. They had never met an inventor before, unless you counted Biff Rifkin, who'd once come up with a small wooden cage used to catch giant moths when they descended from the hills in the autumn. At the mention of Kaftan Minor, Victor had also perked up. It was a city he'd heard about in stories from other strangers who had passed through Rainwater, and it sounded like the most exciting place imaginable. He was sure that if he ever got there, he'd find kids more like him than the ones in his hometown. "It's true," the inventor continued, bouncing eagerly on spindly legs that looked ready to collapse beneath his belly. "I come to you from a distant place, where chalky cliffs meet the raging sea, scaly birds munch the smoky clouds, and great silver beasts haul themselves through the salty water. With me are three new contraptions that are sure to enrich your lives immeasurably."
He smiled, revealing two rows of perfectly straight, gleaming teeth, and patted his belly as though he were pregnant.
"Now," he said, "may I have a volunteer?"
A number of hands shot into the air. Villagers bounced on their tiptoes, eager to be chosen. Everyone wanted to be the first to experience whatever their visitor had to offer. Finally, Walter Swizwit selected Miss Sprocket, who bustled up onto the stage inside the wagon. She stood excitedly in her muddied jumpsuit, coarse hands raised above her head.
"Madam," said the inventor, "I am about to pass you a most ingenious piece of newfangled technology. You may be taken aback at first, but do not fear. It is there to help."
The inventor produced a burlap sack and sank one arm into it.
"Ladies and gentlemen, I present to you the mirror of Emmett Tsol."
With a flourish, he pulled out a large, shimmery disc of metal, which he passed to Miss Sprocket.
"Please," he told her, "take a careful look into this."
Miss Sprocket held the disc up before her face. She raised one eyebrow and opened her mouth, closed her mouth, and flared her nostrils.
"What do you see?" asked the inventor eagerly.
Miss Sprocket peered closer and closer and closer until the nose of her reflection in the metal disc touched her real nose.
"Well,"
urged the inventor.
"I think it's me," said Miss Sprocket. "Although I couldn't tell you for sure. I've seen myself a couple of times in the duck pond."
She moved her face away from the mirror and wrinkled her nose.
"What's the point in that?"
"That's reflecting," shouted one of the villagers. "Same as a bucket of water does. Just because we live in the countryside doesn't make us idiots."
"What do we need reflecting for anyways?"
asked Miss Sprocket.
"Well," said the inventor, "to see how you look." "Why would we need to see how we look?" "So you can make yourselves look better."
The villagers of Rainwater grumbled about this, upset by the suggestion that there was something wrong with how they looked already. Miss Sprocket tossed the mirror to Walter Swizwit, who dropped it, and watched with horror as it shattered into 1,000 glinting pieces around his feet.
"That's 7 years bad luck," muttered the inventor, patting his belly nervously. "Yeah?" said an unimpressed Miss Sprocket. "Who said?"
She took her place back amongst the crowd of villagers.
"Perhaps the divine mirror was not for you," said Walter Swizwit, trying not to appear flustered. "But I have no doubt my next creation will transform all of your lives."
The villagers were not convinced. They had become restless and irritable and impatient with their visitor. Victor, on the other hand, wanted to hear everything and anything the inventor had to say. He didn't mind that the invention seemed useless. He wanted to hear more about Caftan Minor. Theatrically, Walter Swizwit sank his hand into the bag once more and came out with what looked to be a pair of wooden binoculars. The device resembled a pair of chunky glasses fitted onto an oblong box, so that whoever put the spectacles on would see only the insides of the box. No one had any idea what it could be for.
"This," the inventor said, "is a green grass stereoscope. The very first of its kind, capable of providing an experience that is sure to be life-changing. Who would like to try it?"
People were less keen to volunteer this time. Their hopes for what the inventor might show them were fading rapidly. Hurriedly, Walter Swizwit called up a boy named Pockets Morgan and thrust the device between his hands.
"Have a look in there," he told the boy.
Pockets Morgan pushed the device against his eyes and let out a chirp of surprise.
"Well," said the inventor, "what do you see?"
"It's people," Pockets Morgan said. "I can see people."
"Yes," said Walter Swizwit. "And what are those people doing?"
"They're running around on a beach, holding ice cream."
"And?"
"They're having more fun than I am."
"Isn't it wonderful?"
"No,"
said Pockets Morgan, lowering the stereoscope from his face.
"No, I want to be on a beach and I'm stuck here in this stupid village."
"Watch your tongue," shouted Pockets Morgan's father from the crowd. "This is a perfectly decent village filled with perfectly decent people."
"But look," said the inventor. "Now you've got dreams, ambition, ideas about where you'd like to be. Now you know what the world has to offer, and you'll stop at nothing to get it."
Victor wished that he'd been chosen to look through the green grass stereoscope. Pockets Morgan looked sadly around at the villagers.
"Why is there no beach? Why isn't there any ice cream?"
His father dragged him out of the wagon.
"We don't have time to watch other people having fun," he said. "We have things to do, fields to plough, cows to milk, children to bath."
"Who is this man anyway?"
someone shouted.
"Let's go home. He's obviously a lunatic."
"Wait!"
called the inventor.
"I have one more invention for you all, and it is sure to astound, amaze, and inspire."
"You said that last time," pointed out Victor's mother. "And then you pulled out wooden binoculars and said the world had more to offer than our village."
"Well, I've saved the best for last," promised the inventor. "You'll see. Prepare yourselves for the movable world."
They watched with their arms crossed as the inventor pulled a series of objects out of his bag and arranged them on the podium. First came a wooden barn, about the size of a shoebox. One side of the barn swung open to reveal its inside, which was set out exactly like a real barn, with feeding troughs, pens, and bales of hay. Next came the animals, pigs, horses, goats, and sheep, each no bigger than a thumb, and all capable of making lifelike sounds, and leaving behind lifelike deposits. Finally, the inventor brought out a farmer, and placed him proudly beside the animals. The villagers muttered loudly to each other.
"This," said the inventor,
gesturing grandly with his arms, is a miniature farm that you can operate almost exactly as if it were an actual real-life farm.
The villagers of Rainwater fell silent.
Why would we want to do that?
Someone asked.
Because, said the travelling salesman, it's fun.
At that, the villagers burst out laughing. They bent in half and slapped their knees and roared until they couldn't breathe. Why would it be any fun to run a tiny farm? They already ran normal-sized farms, and that could hardly be called fun. Fulfilling, perhaps, satisfying maybe, but certainly not fun.
Now that, said someone, was funny.
As they left, a few people hurled rotten vegetables while others invented insults and showered the inventor with them. Walter Swizwit stood beside his wagon, turning a deep, dark shade of red. He ground his teeth and stamped his feet and patted his belly like someone trying to put out a fire. The villagers returned to their homes and continued tittering to themselves about what they'd seen. Crusty heels of bread and cauldrons of chicken soup were warmed and shared. If he hadn't brought any useful inventions, they agreed, he'd at least given them a chuckle. Laughter in Rainwater was in short supply. Now it was time to think about the morning and the challenges it would bring. There were scarecrows that needed new hats, horses that needed new shoes. Only Victor didn't laugh. He was too disappointed to find it funny. Seeing that wagon roll down the mountainside, he'd hoped for a glimpse into the wider world. Instead, all it had brought were cheap tricks. Chapter 3. The inventor drew the velvet curtains across his wagon and sat in the darkness, seething, surrounded by his inventions.
How dare they laugh, he muttered to himself. Those slow-minded, shovel-handed, straw-brained farm folk. How dare they mock me? They are only savages, he told himself. Simple people from the country who can't grasp anything more exciting than a wooden spoon.
But those savages were getting in the way of his plans. It was absolutely necessary that he made as much gold as possible. If he didn't, he would fail. And he couldn't afford to fail. Everyone else between this wretched valley and the Eastern Ocean had bought the inventions. So what made the villagers of Rainwater think they were so special? He pictured the villagers in their homes laughing about him. The more he thought, the angrier he got.
Well, the inventor said to himself, not a single villager in this reeking hamlet will be laughing come morning, I'll see to that.
And he crept out of his old wagon and snuck among the huts, hopping between pools of darkness. He knew what he was looking for, and soon he found it. In the centre of the village of Rainwater was a well so deep that folk claimed if you fell into it, you'd fall for 3 days. Every morning the villagers drew water from it for their breakfast teas. Every morning each villager drank at least 3 cups of some kind of tea. Theirs was a community built on tea. There were special teas for funerals, teas for birthdays, teas for Tuesdays and Fridays, and the days of first and last snow. Standing over that deep well, the inventor unfolded a handkerchief and shook a sprinkling of silver dust into its water.
He cackled to himself. That should sort them out, he whispered.
On the village green, he closed the curtains over his wagon and climbed up to the front. He took the reins of his horse and urged her on.
On you go, girl, he told the horse,
adjusting the black and white photograph of his sister that he kept tucked into his jacket pocket.
We've plenty more places to see yet.
And I'm sure we'll get a warmer welcome than ever we got here. Chapter 4. The next morning, Victor was woken again by St. Oswald nipping at his feet. He nudged the animal away and rolled over.
Ook, ook,
said St. Oswald, launching himself off the bed. The giant tortoise landed on his back and was forced to wait for the boy to get up and right him. Victor was still halfway through a dream. He watched the bald and roaring monster advance, turned to run, and blinked his eyes open.
I was dreaming, he told the ceiling. It was just a dream.
Victor climbed out of bed, picked up St. Oswald, pulled on some dirty clothes from the floor, and headed outside. Together they raced to their normal spot at the top of the smallest mountain. The sun rose, soft and warm on the slopes of the valley. Carpets of dew sparkled in the light. Victor hoped that another wagon was about to come rumbling into view. It didn't, of course. He knew it could be months, even years, before another peddler stopped by. What was it like in the deepest east? Was there really an ocean? And did it really reach to the end of the world? Did the people play violins and whistles and read from thick old books filled with the kinds of stories that the strangers who had passed through Rainwater told? Surely, he thought, the people in the cities would make sense to him, and he would make sense to them. He lingered a little longer than usual on the top of the mountain, lost in his thoughts. We'd better go, Oz, he said finally. I'm sure Mum's written our list of chores already. They hurried down the mountain. Before they reached the bottom, Victor slowed his pace. Something was wrong. Rather than the usual morning bustle, the village streets were deserted. Not a single person could be seen out of their hut. This had never happened before. Almost everyone would be awake by the time Victor returned from the mountain, even if most of them chose to ignore him entirely. Could they all just be sleeping in? Cautiously, Victor pushed open the door to his house. He saw his mum and dad lying on the kitchen floor, balled up like newborn babies. They both appeared to be in great pain, squawking like frightened birds.
Don't drink the water,
his father bellowed from below the kitchen table.
It's poisoned.
It's true, whimpered his mother. We can barely move and our stomachs feel like explosions. Your father's already chucked up both his lungs.
Victor wrinkled his nose. He helped his parents get up and led them through to their bedroom. They collapsed into bed. Sweat ran from their heads and their hands trembled. Their eyes were threaded with red and the skin of their cheeks was turning yellow.
Did the inventor do this? Victor asked. Did he do this to you because no one bought his stupid inventions?
Of course,
shouted his father.
Who else? The impish charlatan has ruined us.
Go and see the great aunt, his mother insisted. Ask for medicine. She'll know what to do.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.